Meanwhile, 10,000 miles away in London, a music production team called PWL were riding on a crest of a wave bigger than the ones on Bell's Beach in Melbourne.
The success of PWL Records is down to that. Three talented people there, Mike Stott, Matt Aitken and Pete Waterman. Yeah, this is the production team, Michael Kaczynski and Gary Astley, who are the two guys who ran Mushroom. And they asked Pete if he would produce Kylie. And he said basically no, but I'll send someone over to do it. So in the summer before Kylie came over to the UK, we sent a guy called Mike Duffy, who was one of our engineers, over, and he produced The Locomotion, the original version, which went all the way to number one in Australia.
Mushroom Records decided there was only one thing to do: take Kylie to London to work with producers Stock, Aitken and Waterman. In October 1986, during a break from filming Neighbours, Kylie travelled to the UK to work with the trio of top writer producers who seemed to have the Midas touch. Everything they produced turned to gold records. Kylie just had a taste of success with The Locomotion, and now she was full steam ahead. She just needed to get on track.
We got known as the Hit Factory fairly quickly.
They were producers of that age, I think, the 80s. Massive, churning out the big hits, the sort of early electronic sort of vibe and good songs. Really cool.
Pete was going for an 80s style Tamla Motown domination of the pop charts. Nothing left the building without Pete Waterman's approval. And he had the kind of ears where he knew, I would say 90% of the time, what was going to work commercially.
Stock, Aitken and Waterman already had a track record. They had done disco with Hazel Dean, and they'd done a kind of camp new romantic song with Dead or Alive, and they had Bananarama, who were a massively successful girl group.
We were riding high with Mel and Kim, we were riding high with Rick Astley, mixing for the Pet Shop Boys.
Kylie helped them break through from being very successful kind of disco, slightly camp producers into pure pop top 10.
Nobody in the building knew anything about Kylie Minogue. We didn't know anything about Neighbours. None of us had heard of it. Pete had never heard of Kylie Minogue. It was just a girl in Australia that Gary and Michael wanted to do a single with.
But when Kylie arrived in London, Stock, Aitken and Waterman were not ready for her. And so, for a week, she spent her time sightseeing in London without ever seeing the inside of a recording studio.
And the day before she's leaving, Pete goes, "We'll get her in the studio." We had a guy working for us there called Peter Pitstop doing disco promotions, and he was always queuing it up every day. And when somebody said to him, "Have you got a boyfriend?" he'd go, "I should be so lucky." And Mike picked up on that "I should be so lucky" and wrote a song around that.
It took half an hour maximum for her to put the vocal on "I Should Be So Lucky."
Kylie had a nice voice, you know, and it was like teen, you know, it was a teen voice. Four on the floor bass, high energy, with simple lyrics that people could sing along to. Music for the kids. We offered it to 10 major record companies and they all turned it down, every single one of them. And so we decided that we're going to put Kylie on PWL.
I remember Mike saying how impressed he was with Kylie's attitude, considering she's waited a week to do this. It took, yeah, one take pretty much.
Michael Hurl, who was produced Top of the Pops and Noel Edmonds' Christmas Day special, saw Kylie in Australia, and he wanted Kylie on it.
So there we had the right record at the right time with a massive TV plug.
Meanwhile, on the other side of the world, Kylie waited nervously to find out if she was lucky or unlucky. Had the record gone into the UK charts?
"I Should Be So Lucky" was 31, and we had a career for Kylie Minogue.
We had the mums and dads here because they liked the song. They liked it because it's ABBA-ish. We had the kids here because that was a teen idol. And we had the gay fraternity over here. So we got the whole market.
But helping her keep her courage and lending more than perhaps an ear was her new boyfriend, Michael Hutchins.
Well, commercially, Kylie was undoubtedly our biggest artist and the best thing that commercially happened for PWL. But she was caught up in that flow of changing from
club DJ credibility to losing that and just being called pop.
I think it's natural for any artist at some point to want to have a more input. Michael Hutchence obviously lived a completely different life in a completely different world, completely different kind of music. Kylie was obviously interested in all of that, what was going on, because it was different.
I saw a recent concert and her genuine enthusiasm and enjoyment of delivering the music to her audience still comes through.